This video is brought to you by Captivating History. Spartacus, Origins. Spartacus, Gladiator, Freedom Fighter, Terror of the Roman Republic, leader of the most successful slave revolt in Roman history. Even 2,000 years later, his story still elicits excitement and admiration. What we know about him only comes from historians writing centuries after the events of the Third Servile War. There are no known contemporary accounts written from the perspective of the rebels or Spartacus himself. Mystery surrounds Spartacus's origins. He may have been born in 111 BCE in Thrace. This Roman client kingdom lay where Bulgaria, Greece, and Turkey meet. Spartacus was likely from the nomadic Medi tribe. There is even speculation he was royalty, as there were Thracian kings named Spartacus. As a young man, he joined the Roman army, more than likely serving as a mercenary. His lack of Roman citizenship would have prevented him from being a legionary. Here, Spartacus learned the art of war and, by careful observation, how to command men. Eventually, fed up of army discipline, he deserted, turning to a life of banditry to survive. If captured, a deserter from the Roman army was punished, either by being banished or being bludgeoned to death by former comrades. However, in Spartacus's case, he was sold into slavery. The Thracian was tall, muscled, and a born warrior. Valuable. His captors sold him to Badiatis, the owner of a gladiator school in Capua, near Naples. Although there are no records of Spartacus performing as a gladiator, it is believed he fought as a Thrax, a cruel parody of a Thracian warrior. He would have entered the arena bare-chested, but armed with a parmala, a small shield, and a sika, a short sword. His other armor would have included shin protectors and a visored helmet. The escape to Mount Vesuvius. Life in the gladiator school was grueling. They trained hard and were punished for any resistance. They had good food and medical care, but were shackled in tiny cells at night. Their sole purpose was to entertain the bloodthirsty masses and make money for their owner. What had begun as Etruscan funeral rites had devolved into a lucrative spectator sport. Successful gladiators were celebrities, but that did not change that they were slaves and expendable in the arena. Spartacus became friends with two of his fellow gladiators, Gallic fighters called Crixus and Onomaus. They eventually became his seconds in command. One night in 73 BCE, the Thracian and 78 of his comrades escaped from their cells. Making their way to the kitchens, they armed themselves with whatever sharp implements they could find. Guards who tried to stop them were cut down. The newly liberated gladiators went on the run in the countryside near Naples. They pillaged farms for food, equipment, and weapons, and encouraged the slaves they met to join their ever-growing force. Their destination was nearby Mount Vesuvius. They believed it would be difficult for the surviving gladiator school's guards to pursue them up its steep slopes. However, they knew more disciplined troops would find it much easier. About 3,000 Roman soldiers eventually arrived, but they were hardly top-notch legionnaires. Due to ongoing wars in Spain and elsewhere, the best legions were outside of Italy. Rome had sent a praetor, Gaius Claudius Glaber, whose laziness and arrogance were about to deliver a slap in the face to the Republic. En route from Rome, he had raised an ad hoc militia, which would prove no match for the battle-hardened gladiators. Glaber reasoned he could easily starve them out by blocking the one road up the volcano. And so, his men hunkered down and waited for surrender. They were so confident of victory that they didn't even bother to fortify their camp. With the road blocked, Spartacus had only one other option: use the cliffs. The mountainside was green with wild vines, which were fashioned into ropes. During the night, Spartacus and his men rappelled down the cliff face and attacked the unsuspecting Romans. It was a complete rout. Those soldiers who could escape fled into the darkness, abandoning the camp. Spartacus and his men helped themselves to the weapons and everything else that had been left behind. This victory marked the beginning of the Third Servile War. As Spartacus's forces moved through the countryside, more slaves joined them. Some even brought their families. This army of runaway slaves was about to send a shockwave through the Roman Republic. The Third Servile War. Victories. What followed over the next 2 years was a series of fatal errors made by arrogant Roman leaders. At first, they underestimated the sheer determination of the former slaves to achieve freedom. After Glaber's defeat, Rome sent another praetor, Publius Verinius, to put down the rebellion. Not only did his efforts end in a humiliating defeat, but Verinius himself barely survived and had his horse stolen. Rome then took the threat from this rebel army seriously. Slaves made up one-third of Italy's population, so there was real fear that word of Spartacus's victories would ignite uprisings across the Republic. The rebel army now numbered tens of thousands of men as the winter of 73 BCE approached. But a long-standing rift between Spartacus and Crixus had grown even wider with each victory against the Romans. Filled with bitterness and rage about past mistreatment, Crixus longed to march on Rome and take his revenge. Spartacus just wanted to go home. The army was split into two, one heading north with Spartacus to cross the Alps into Gaul, and the other continuing south under Crixus's command. This division of the force was to prove a deadly mistake. Rome's next move was to send multiple legions out under the command of consuls Gnaeus Cornelius Lentulus Gladinius and Lucius Gellius Publicola. In the spring of 72 BCE, Publicola attacked Crixus's band of 30,000 men near Mount Gargano. By the end, two-thirds of them lay dead, including Crixus himself. When Spartacus heard the news, he held his own funeral games, using Roman prisoners of war as gladiators. Within weeks, as he marched toward the Alps, Spartacus met and destroyed Gladinius's forces, surprising them with cavalry rather than infantry. He then turned around and did the same thing to Publicola, who had hoped to catch the rebel army in a pincer maneuver. One more decisive battle at Picenium against the combined Roman forces saw Gladinius and Publicola returning home in disgrace. Morale amongst the legions dipped to an all-time low. Then, Marcus Licinius Crassus came along and shook things up. Enter Crassus and the end of Spartacus. Crassus may have been the richest man in Rome, but he longed for military glory and recognition. Deeply jealous of the successes of General Pompey, Crassus wanted to have his own triumphal military parade through the streets of Rome. The Senate called upon Crassus to take on the rebel army. The first thing he did was to punish his men for their past failures in the field. Using decimation, every 10th soldier was chosen to be beaten to death by his comrades. The troops soon learned to fear Crassus more than their Thracian foe. The latter had abandoned his plans to cross the Alps at the last minute and headed back south. Spartacus was now camped in Bruttium, trying to negotiate crossing the Strait of Messina to Sicily with Sicilian pirates. Unfortunately, the pirates took his money and then disappeared. Meanwhile, Crassus was swiftly moving south. The Rhegium Peninsula became the site of a massive 37-mile-wide system of defensive ditches and walls. The Roman leader intended to trap the rebel army between it and the sea, but Spartacus and his men still somehow escaped his grasp. There was a failed attempt at a truce on Spartacus's part. The spring of 71 BCE saw the scene set for the final encounter between the two sides at the Salarius River. Complicating matters for Crassus was the imminent arrival of Pompey and one other commander with their forces. To secure his glorious victory, Crassus needed to crush Spartacus and his army once and for all. Spartacus knew that battle was inevitable and would probably go against him. He killed his horse, boldly proclaiming to his men that if he won, there would be many horses to choose from, but that if he lost, he wouldn't need one. On the day, the rebels charged the Romans and fought hard. Spartacus tried desperately to reach Crassus, but received a serious leg wound in the attempt. Despite this, he continued fighting while on his knees, killing several more soldiers before being overpowered and killed. His body was never found. The slave revolt was over. Modern estimates put the number of rebel casualties at 36,000. Crassus had 6,000 prisoners of war crucified along the Via Appia. Their bodies were left to rot as a symbol of the heavy price of challenging the might of Rome. A further 5,000 men, who had initially escaped, met a similar fate on Pompey's orders. In an ironic twist, Pompey took all the credit for the Roman victory and was given a triumph. Crassus, who had done all the hard work, received only an ovation, a much smaller public acknowledgement. Spartacus's legacy. Over the centuries, Spartacus's story still inspires people seeking freedom and justice. His legacy continues to shine brightly. To discover more about Spartacus, then check out our book, Spartacus, A Captivating Guide to the Thracian Gladiator Who Led the Slave Rebellion Called the Third Servile War Against the Roman Republic. It's available as an ebook, paperback, and audiobook. Also, grab your free Mythology Bundle ebook for free while it's still available. All links are in the description. If you enjoyed the video, hit the like button and subscribe for more videos like this.